this has many of the advantages that Shelby's algorithm and framework has. But the difference is that it focuses on quantum linear algebra and quantum algorithms that can be cast in this language. And it has the benefit that it makes it easier to design and analyze algorithms. And since this technique is based and motivated by actual quantum physics insights, the arising quantum circuits are already very efficient, which is a nice feature of this framework. And we wrote a paper, which is some sort of a superposition between a research and a survey paper with my co-authors, Yuan Su, Juan Carlo, and Nathan Weeb. And if you have more questions about this technique after my talk, you can find out more in this paper. So when you design quantum algorithms, it's very convenient to live in fantasy world where you have a large, fully error-corrected quantum computer when you don't need to worry about any practical details. You can just focus on the gold standards of quantum algorithm designs and seek out exponential speedups or other large quantum speedups. But these algorithms that people design when living in this fantasy world are sometimes hard to implement. And of course, we eventually want to make these algorithms run on a quantum hardware. So here is often faced the question like, okay, how practical is your algorithm? Is it actually going to fit on this hardware, which we have the near term? And if the algorithm is very complicated, then it can be really challenging to analyze, and it's a very hard question to answer. So it's useful to have a theoretical framework which already gives you efficient circuits right away. So I would like to introduce this framework by starting with a bird's eye view on quantum linear algebra. And I would like to start with the motivation of the HHL algorithm, which is one of the most influential quantum linear algebra algorithms, where we want to solve a large system of linear equations, AX equals B. And it is very promising because a quantum computer can nicely work with exponentially large matrices. And therefore, we want to phrase this problem in a way that this is a quantum question. So given a quantum state proportional to B, we would like to prepare a quantum state which is proportional to the solution A inverse B. And so if we look at this problem from far enough, we can see that we have an input matrix A, and we have some sort of implementation of this matrix, which can either come from some sparsity assumptions or really any sort of assumptions. The only important thing is that we need to have a quantum circuit, which is of course a unitary matrix if we describe as a linear operator. And we need this A matrix as top left corner of this unitary matrix. And then our algorithm will be simply to design a new quantum circuit, U prime, where the top left corner is some function of this original matrix. And in case of this matrix inversion problem, we just want to apply the 1 over x function, which will invert the matrix. And this can be achieved using quantum single value transformation. If someone read the original paper, knows that actually implementing this HHL algorithm in the original version is much more challenging. It uses phase estimation, all things that we can skip this way. And it turns out that this rough view that I just presented you actually fits many quantum algorithms. You can view in the same way the optimal Hamiltonian simulation algorithm of Low and Chuang, quantum walks, fixed point oblivious ability amplification, HHL and variants of it like regression problems, semi-definite program solving, linear program solving, and all sorts of other machine learning problems. So, yes, it's widely applicable. And now I would like to turn to a little bit more why we choose this so-called block encoding when we look at these matrices at top left, as the top left corner of unitary matrix. This is a very useful point of view because any matrix, any complex matrix with operator norm at most one, can in principle be embedded into unitary matrix like that. And indeed, there are many settings when you can efficiently do such a circuit, construct a circuit which does this efficiently. And while the most simplest case is when A itself is a unitary matrix, then of course it's a block encoding of itself, just the whole matrix is unitary. But if your matrix is sparse with efficiently computable elements, matrix elements, then you can also do such circuits, or matrix is stored in some clever data structure in a quantum realm, you can do it, or it's a density operator that you can prepare a purification of, or maybe most interestingly for physicists, if you have a POVM operator M, where you can somehow sample from a random variable trace rho M, so it's like a expectation value that you can in some way measure, then you can also implement the block encoding of this POVM operator. And the nice thing is that once you have block encodings, you can combine them. You can, if you have like A1 to AM, AJ matrices, then you can just implement convex combination of those. And if you have two matrix A and B, then you can just basically literally take the product of the corresponding unitaries, and then you can get a block encoding of A times B. It's a little bit more complicated than that, but it's still very simple. And so once we have this nice view of block encoded matrices, we can state, we can do linear algebra with them, addition, multiplication, and we have quantum single value transformation. And the main result about this is the following. So suppose that we have a polynomial map P, which is a bounded polynomial on the interval -1, 1, maps it to -1, 1. It's an odd polynomial, meaning that only the odd powers have non-zero coefficient. Then we have the following. If we have a block encoding of a matrix A, which can always describe as some singular value decomposition as in the slide, then we can turn it to a new block encoding, a new quantum circuit, where the top left corner has the same singular value decomposition, but the singular values are transformed according to this polynomial. And so this circuit, if the polynomial had degree d, then this quantum circuit essentially uses d rotation angles in a clever way. And this is the quantum circuit. So it has basically d blocks, and in each block you apply the unitary or its inverse, which is the block encoding. And then you apply in each block a Toffoli gate, and then a rotation on a single qubit, and then another Toffoli gate. And the only thing that depends on the polynomial itself is this degree is this angle sequence, phi 1 to phi d, which is acting on this single qubit. And similar result holds for even polynomials. And if you don't like to think about singular values, then you can also think about eigenvalues in case the matrix is actually Hermitian. And so now I would like to show how it solves the HHR problem. If we have the matrix A, then it has some singular decomposition, and the pseudo inverse, which is the generalized inverse of the matrix A, denoted by A plus, has this decomposition, where we need to reverse the order of the unitaries in the singular value decomposition, and we need to take the inverse of the diagonal matrix elements that are non-zero. So if this is the spectrum of the matrix, then we want to implement the 1 over x function on it. But this is not a bounded function, and we need to use bounded functions. That's also, it's not continuous, so we can't do this in general. But if we assume that the smallest non-zero singular value of the matrix is not too small, or in other words, this effective condition number is not too large, kappa, then we can just take a polynomial which only approximates this function at the relevant interval above 1 over kappa, and then use this as our approximating polynomial, and then we get by our quantum single value transformation a very efficient algorithm which has low value independence and error and all sorts of nice features. And the nice thing is that the same story can be told if you just use a different function and approximate that function with polynomials, then we get a totally different algorithm. For example, we use sine x and cosine x, we get Hamiltonian simulation. If we use an exponential decay, then it gives rise to Gibbs sampling. Or, as it turns out, singular value transformation is a generalization of global search, an amplification or quantum walks, as a matter of fact, where if you look at these algorithms from this point of view, then it turns out that these algorithms just do singular value transformation according to a Chebyshev polynomial. So you can see, as you use more and more iterations of the original circuits, then in this graph, where the horizontal axis is like the amplitude of the original success probability, then it quickly rises. So this really amplifies. If you have a very small amplitude, then it goes to almost one, very close to zero. And as you have more and more iterations, it gets steeper to one. But here is a problem with this approach, that there is a so-called overshooting, when if your original probability was a bit higher than you expected, then you might actually overamplify and you don't get such a high success probability. But in this point of view, it's very easy to fix this problem. Instead of using a Chebyshev polynomial, just use an approximating polynomial, which quickly jumps up to almost one. And then using this polynomial, you can get a so-called fixed point amplification algorithm where there is no risk of overshooting. So all of this happens using this simple quantum circuit. If we have a unitary which is potentially a Hamiltonian or some Markov chain, then depending on which angles we choose, the same circuit we apply except these single qubit rotation angles, and then we get very different algorithms. If we use a specific sequence of angles, we get Hamiltonian simulation. If we change the angles, we might get a Gibbs sampler. If we again change the angles, we might get a quantum walk. And it's the same circuit. So it's very interesting how these single qubit rotations change the landscape of the whole algorithm and the whole quantum circuit. And it's related to the talks from yesterday when in Otox had some similar effect with scrambled unitaries or in this quantum gravity in the lab experiments. It's also all related to this phenomenon. And so it sounds pretty magical, I guess. So I just wanted to get a little bit of insight, and I believe that Lin will talk more about these techniques. The underlying technique is called quantum signal processing. And I just would like to connect the dots there. So, so the question that that Lo, Yoder, and Chuang asked in their beautiful paper from 4 years ago was the following. Suppose that you have a unitary which implements some x rotation with some unknown angle, which is now, for simplicity, I denoted by r cosine x. Then it has some matrix formulation like this. And then you can ask the question, suppose that I can apply some control, some z rotations with some angles that I can control. Then what sort of unitaries can I get as a result of this? And a characterization of this problem gave rise to this theorem that I described. And the way it gives rise to this problem is that we can view this from, again, a bird's-eye perspective, that the input is a matrix where the top left corner is just a 1 by 1 matrix, number x. We have some modulations, some z rotations, and the output will be a new quantum circuit where the top left corner is just p of x. And if I don't do anything, just copy this matrix next to each other many times with x and y, different numbers, then I get a 2 by 2 example. And if I just look at the same matrix, just rearrange the tensor factors, then I get a diagonal matrix, x and y. And of course, the mathematics works the same way. And now you can jump one more step. Actually, any matrix can be diagonalized using the single value decomposition, and the same technique works. So this is a very brief sketch of why this result could may work. And so just as a summary, I would like to briefly sketch what type of speedups can this framework recover. So there are exponential speedups that arise, for example, from the dimensionality of the Hilbert space, which appear in the Hamiltonian simulation algorithms, or from precise polynomial approximations that appear in improved HH algorithm, for example. There are quadratic speedups, which stem from the fact that singular values are, in general, the square roots of the probabilities, like in Grover search, or single values are easier to distinguish in some sense, which gives rise to amplitude estimation. And in a way, close to one single values are more flexible in this technique, which gives rise to the quadratic speedup in quantum walks. And there are really many other applications, but for the sake of time, I would like to stop here.